Hello, everybody. Do you hear me? This is the webinar on post-harvest management. Let me welcome you. We are overwhelmed by the registrations, and I hope many people who registered for the event will still be able to join us. But welcome very much the ones who are here. Thank you very much for your interest, and I am looking forward to our exchange on bringing post-harvest management solutions to scale. Je veux dire bonjour aussi aux francophones ici, à cette occasion-ci. I am sorry you have to bear with us for speaking English. Mais merci beaucoup quand même pour votre intérêt et pour participer. Wanted to change the slide, but somehow it's not going on. Thank you very much. So just a short background in which framework this webinar takes place. It is part of the project called Post-Harvest Management in Sub-Saharan Africa. And the objective of this project is to improve food security of smallholder men and women farmers in Sub-Saharan Africa through the reduction of post-harvest losses of food crops like grains and pulses within a market systems approach. This project works in two pilot countries, in Benin and in Mozambique, and it has a regional outreach. It took place in a first phase between 2013 and 2017, with a focus on testing technologies, business models, and good practices. And now we are in the second phase of this project that will end in 2020, where we aim at scaling up and out of the proven technologies and good practices and bring them to scale at national and at regional level. The project is implemented by a consortium led by Helvetas Swiss Intercorporation, and part of the consortium is the African Forum Agricultural Advisory Services, AFAS, the Food and Natural Resources Policy Analysis Network, FANAPAN, and AgriDEA, which is the Swiss Center for Agricultural Advisory and Extension Services. This project, again, is part of a bigger initiative of the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation, SDC, who supports several initiatives on post-harvest management in Africa. In addition to the project just mentioned, it's the grain post-harvest loss prevention project in Tanzania. And then there are other projects that take place in Ethiopia and in Burkina Faso, Congo, and Uganda that are supported by the Swiss Development and Cooperation Agency. So this was a little bit of the background. Now let's go to the program for this event. So we are right now in the introduction, which will be followed by an input on the call for joint action on post-harvest management. And this input will be given by Raphael Dischl from Helvetas. After that, we will have a part where you can join us and where we are very much looking forward to your stories on communication of post-harvest management solutions and on the private sector engagement in the area. Before we go to a conclusion where we can hopefully see some salient questions and have a reflection on them, and we will close the latest at 16 hours in Kampala time or or 15 hours for Central European time. Yes, and that you know a little bit who is behind this webinar. There's a little who is who. We have first our presenter, Rafael Dischi from Helvetas, as I said before. You will see him in a moment. My name is Angela. I'm the facilitator of this webinar. And I am supported by our chat moderator, Evelyn Speichberg, who is the one in the picture below. And then there is a very important person who is sitting beside me and whose picture is the second one from below. That is Cesar Robles. And he will do some, he is doing the technical backstopping of this webinar. Thank you all for your contribution. We will now have a little introduction on the technical possibilities and opportunities that you have as participants. I give you the floor, Cesar.
Thank you, Angela. Welcome everyone from wherever you're joining us from. I just want to give you a little bit of technical advice to ensure your participation is smooth and you can take advantage of all our tools. First of all, your microphone is off for everyone. You will be able to open it if you have a question only during the last part of this webinar in the questions and answers session. In the meantime, if you have any comment or any question about the presentation, you can already post it in the chat, which is on the bottom left of this screen. We have our colleague Evelyn, who is moderating the chat, so she will make sure that your comment or your question is collected to bring it up back in the questions and answers session, or that there's a follow-up by the presenters. And my third advice is, if you can't hear or see, or if at any point you have any troubles with the webinar, the best is that you hang up this whole call, that you leave the webinar, close your browser, and join again from scratch. You can also join from your mobile phone using the Click Meeting app. If the problems persist, then you can also send me an email and I will try to give some support one-on-one. I also want to inform you that this webinar is being recorded and it will be available online afterwards. Thank you very much, and back to you, Angela.
Thank you very much, Cesar, for these instructions. When we are thinking at this discussion, and well, we are not yet so many participants, but still, if you can go back to my presentation, please. Still, it would be good that we think a little bit how we can make this discussion very fruitful. So once you are speaking and there might be somebody else still in the line, we think ourselves of being polite and letting everybody finish his or her input. Then I would be happy if everybody, as important as your message will be for us, can be concise and tell his or her story in maximum 2 minutes of speaking time. We are also happy if you can keep focused on to the questions and discussion themes. And in the chat, yes, you can use the arrobas at sign if you want to address a particular person from whom you might see a message in the chat. Yes, and yes, patience is wisdom. It's techniques, and we have a very good support, but there might be some moments where we have to wait for something to be uploaded or changed, or until somebody has taken the word and opened the microphone. So thank you very much already for your patience. Now, I would very much like to make you familiar with the poll tool again. So we would like to know where you join us from, so that we have a little bit an overview where our audience comes from. In fact, in the registrations, it was people from all around the world and nearly every country of Africa. So I hope we can see this coming still. So please, now you should see the question and the menu. So you should be able to vote. Can you please start your voting? And then we will show you the results of the vote. Aha, now the results should be here. Okay, so we have persons from Southern Africa, Eastern Africa, Western Africa. Sorry for being not more exact, but this is at least we have an idea. We have nobody yet from Northern Africa, but Sub-Saharan Africa, where we aim at, is very well presented. Aha, and there are people coming from Africa also, but joining us from Europe. So yes, so you are maybe in different categories at the same time. Yes, thank you for your answers. Now, I would like to go to our presentation. Aha, okay. Now we can do this second poll, and so we would like to know you a little bit more and to know where you work at. So can you please also answer this poll question so we know where you are working at? So I guess you are giving your pulse. Okay, has everybody voted? I think we will close this one and see what is the result. So we have most of participants from international organizations, but also some from NGOs, from farming and related businesses, and from agricultural advisory or extension. That is very good. The university people are very occupied. They cannot join us, it seems, for the moment. Maybe we will see later. Okay, so can we have the last poll for this section? Also to get to know you a little bit better, to know where we are. And now we would like to know for how long you are involved in the field of post-harvest management. So is it more than 10 years? Is it more or less between 5 and 9 years? Between 1 and 4 years, or you are perfectly new to the area? So this would help us to also focus a little bit more on some questions. So please answer this poll or give your votes. That would be great. And we are gradually becoming more and more people joining us. Welcome to everybody who has just joined now. I think we close this poll and see what is the result. So we have an interesting distribution. Many people are within the area for between 5 and 9 years. So this will be very interesting discussions, I think. Good. So thank you very much for joining us for these polls. Now I would like to give the word to Rafael, who will join us with his presentation and give us a first input before we will discuss on the related questions. Thank you very much. I hand over to Rafael.
Yeah, hi everyone, good afternoon. I'm sending best greetings from Zurich to from wherever you join us. I'm also happy to be in touch with you through this webinar, and happy to also to speak a bit on a recent experience that was held in Italy. It's the Bellagio learning workshop on post-harvest management last year, from which a document came out, and about which I will talk the analysis that has been discussed during that gathering. Prior to doing that, I would like to come up with a few facts that probably most of you know already. In the world, approximately one third of all food produced is lost or wasted. This is an enormous quantity. And especially in high food insecure regions such as Sub-Saharan Africa, up to 20% of all grains, 44% of roots and tubers, and half of fruits and vegetables are lost, somewhere between harvest and consumption. Apart from these physical losses, there is also substantial degradation in terms of the quality of these food products, which affects the financial value, but also associated, and then therefore also associated incomes, as well as nutritive content, and it can also affect health. And it's also a fact, and that's there it comes, why we spoke about post-harvest management. Most of these losses occur at post-harvest stage. In the African context, it's mostly at the post-harvest stage, meaning during drying, storage, transportation, or the processing stage. If you talk about post-harvest loss, what do we mean by it? Very often we mainly refer to the physical loss in terms of weight, volumes, or calories. However, this is only part of the story. The qualitative losses are at least as important in terms of damage, which can be in terms of animals feeding on foods, in terms of degradation due to molds, etc. There are financial losses that are that have to do with these quality of physical losses, so meaning the loss of value due to the lower quality or the weight loss. There are nutritive losses, for example, loss in vitamins, proteins, minerals, etc., which lowers the nutritive value of the foods due to the bad harvest practices, post-harvest practices. And finally, and not the least, there is also issues connected to food safety. If we talk, for example, about molds that produce mycotoxin, one of the most known one is the aflatoxin toxin, which is a widespread topic in Africa. We have pesticide residues from conservation products, as well as pathogenic, etc. So, and finally, yes, this is the final point. If we talk about post-harvest loss, it means also a loss in terms of resources. Resources that were invested in production, in soil use, in water use, seed use, etc. So we can, if we look at Sub-Saharan Africa, improved post-harvest management, PHM. I will use this abbreviation a bit throughout my presentation. So post-harvest management has the potential to avoid losses that are equivalent to the food and nutrition requirements of almost 50 million people, which is a huge number. Now, coming to this Bellagio Learning Workshop on post-harvest management. The background of it. We know today that there are several technically proven and affordable technologies around for storage, for drying, threshing, etc. Let me mention a few technologies that were tested in SDC's post-harvest management project in Benin and Mozambique. We have the metal silo, which you see in the first picture here, an airtight hermetic system that is produced out of metal sheets, can be produced locally. It's a low-tech technology, and it is very efficient. So without any conservatives, it can, if properly handled and if properly produced, it can reduce post-harvest loss up to 0%. Then we have another technology, the hermetic bags, which are starting now to be used in different countries in Africa, the hermetic bags, which you see on picture 2 and 3. It's the same principle, airtightness, meaning that the pests die if they are within those bags. It's a very well-proven technology, low cost, and it can be produced even locally. And then we have other technologies, just to mention two more in picture 4 and 5. In 4 you see the mechanical thresher, which reduces the breakage of maize, for example. It's produced by local artisans, and it makes the threshing much more effective. Threshing of maize here. In picture 5 you see a drying platform for grain. Different grains can be used there. It makes the drying more proper in terms of less pollution. It's more even drying, meaning that later on in the storage process you will have less loss due to moisture content. So these examples show that there are technologies around that are proven, that are can be used. In Central America, practice or experience has proven that there is also possible that there's a large scale adoption of such technologies, namely the metal silo that had a huge success. Today we can say in countries like Guatemala or Nicaragua, almost 50% of farm households are using such a silo. So there is a possibility to have that as a mainstream technology. However, if you look at sub-Saharan Africa, in the last 10 to 15 years, there were, or maybe even more, there were substantial efforts to promote and test and try to promote these technologies, the same ones like the hermetic bags, the metal silo, and others. Several projects, many projects were investing in this. However, so far, I think I'm right to say that there's no adoption, there's no mainstreaming so far. And projects remain, to a big extent, donor-funded. So this is the background from where this Bellagio workshop started. Helvetas was gladly invited by Rockefeller Foundation last year to hold a learning workshop on post-harvest management in Italy, in the Bellagio town. Seeing that this slow adoption and scaling up of the technologies in Africa, the objectives of this workshop were the following. It was the question, how can we make sure that these technologies or these practices can be brought to scale based on a market system approach? How can we make sure that these technologies can be mainstreamed through certain dissemination and marketing practices and through a market system approach? So there were more than 20 representatives from NGOs, from government organizations, which you see listed here at the right hand side of the slide, also from research, from agricultural organizations, to discuss these questions. Where are the main constraints for large-scale dissemination, and where are the opportunities to do that? In other words, also, we could say, how can the efforts of all the development aid or the development cooperation, or also by private actors, governments, how can these efforts be made more effective in terms of upscaling the post-harvest management technologies? Now, prior to, I want to go into the conclusions or some conclusions from this event. Let me ask you, have you ever heard about this event, about the Bellagio Learning Workshop on post-harvest management? Or have you even participated? Or have you heard about the Bellagio Statement on post-harvest management? May I ask Cesar to open the poll so that we now, yes, you see the questions. Please vote now. Just the third and the fourth question are a bit redundant. That's a mistake, but doesn't matter. You can vote either of them if you have not heard about the event. Yes. Okay, let's look into the analysis. Okay. So it looks that I would say most of those who have voted have not heard about it, but there's still quite some colleagues who have heard about it. The statement was published in end of March this year, so it has not been much time since it was communicated. I will show you a link or certain links at the end of my presentations where you can look, read into the document. So now let's look a bit at the challenges that were identified during that event. On the one hand, there are actually four main constraints that were discussed. On the one hand, it was found that currently post-harvest management is not perceived priority among many stakeholders, both producer side, value chain actors, but also consumers, up to decision makers. So it was found that actually the communication work and awareness raising work around post-harvest management is not yet effective. It is mostly seen as a relatively complex technical issue, which is not so tangible, and although it has rather simple solutions. And there was also, it was felt that there's today still a link missing to other policy topics, for example, nutrition, because post-harvest management has a huge impact on nutrition, on health. I mentioned the aflatoxin question, but good post-harvest management can lead to better aflatoxin control, etc. So there's a failure so far to integrate the topic into the policies. Secondly, it was also found that actually so far we miss economic proof, or let's say, proof, evidences, economic-wise, and economic evidences that say, okay, post-harvest management is beneficial in terms of financial benefits, profits. What we do have increasingly, also especially for Africa, African countries, is that we have data on losses, loss levels happening at different stages of the value chains, of the pulses and grain value chains. For example, there's this AFLIS platform which collects information on this. However, there is too little data information on actually the costs that are needed to reduce. Or in other words, how much investment is actually needed in terms of money, and what is the benefit the ultimate benefit of the farmers or entrepreneurs who invest in these solutions. So this is a hindering factor, or this was found to be a hindering factor for private sector actors, small entrepreneurs, but also those providing funding to initiatives that wants to reduce post-harvest losses. You will see that in the subsequent two slides and on the rest of the webinar, we will focus on these two main topics, awareness and communication and private sector engagement. However, there were two other main constraints identified during that gathering in Bellagio. The first one is, it was found that so far, I mean, there are many, many initiatives around that promote post-harvest management, but there is little coherence. There is little synergies, there is little learning between the different initiatives and organizations. And often, even the approaches between the project seem to contradict or compete each other. And there's a need to make more benefits out of the synergies rather than competition. And fourth, there's a fourth point, which is on policy dialogue and action. I already mentioned it when talking about awareness and communication. So far, governments have only little endorsed post-harvest management as a topic in policies. And there's a need to link those other topics more closely to post-harvest management, namely nutrition and health, knowing that these are topics that are very actual and very urgent in many countries, not only in Africa, but also other countries in the world. So generally, there were four main shifts proposed to further work on post-harvest management in the future. On the one hand, a shift is needed from more the quantitative food loss focus to a more qualitative food loss, or meaning that quality and nutrition should be more prominent in the attention when you talk about post-harvest management. Secondly, post-harvest loss reduction was, in terms of the of storage mainly, was in a main focus in the last year. And this should shift more towards a more holistic or general focus on improved post-harvest management, meaning from the field to fork. So all the practices that contribute to better conservation of food. Thirdly, technology promotion was in the center of most projects so far. Production, development of technologies. However, there was little emphasis on the question, how can these practices and technologies be really promoted through markets? Which entrepreneurs can or want to market these and produce these based on a sustainable business model? And finally, post-harvest management is thematically not only linked to agriculture, it is linked to health, it is linked to economical development, it is linked to many other topics, and this should be considered more in future interventions. So now, coming to my last slides, in terms of the two first topics that I mentioned earlier in the presentation, the Bellagio statement came up with four action points, and I will now talk about two of them, two main of them. The first one, what shall be done about the awareness raising and effective communication? It is proposed that we should rethink and reorient the way how we communicate about post-harvest management. Firstly, both at the level of practitioners, meaning the producers, extensionists, and value chain actors, and also the politicians or decision makers, post-harvest management is often perceived as I already said, a more technical and complex issue. And it was found that this is one factor why it hinders producers and value chain actors to really to enter and to take action. So it was felt that it's important to demonstrate the practical feasibility of post-harvest loss reduction to show that the knowledge and the technologies and practices are already there. You just need to use them. Secondly, it was found that for this purpose, to make the topic more tangible, we need real stories for the communication. We should talk about what happened in reality, in campaigns, in media. For example, I think all of us, and especially if people from Eastern Africa are around and are joining the webinar, you remember the cases of aflatoxin intoxication in Kenya. One of them was in 2004, where more than 100 people died out of acute aflatoxin intoxication, which was due to bad post-harvest management. This is a story that has to do with really affecting people in a specific context, families that lost relatives. So this is part of the story. And the second part of the story is the achievements that have been reached in the last year, for example, in the research on aflatoxin control. One of them is AflaSafe, which is a product developed with support from Gates Foundation and other donors, IITA, which is a strain of the fungus, Aspergillus flavus fungus, that can suppress the harmful fungus, and which, if applied to the field, can control aflatoxin production up to 90%. And there are lots of stories around the farmers who have now solved this problem. So these stories are real, they can be communicated, and they can also trigger action elsewhere in similar contexts. Then thirdly, related to these communication issues, we need to make sure that the messages are really targeted to the people that we talk to. Farmers have a different interest. They are interested in volumes, in their food security, in income generation, in the price that they reach, gain by selling their product. Traders have different interests. Policymakers have other interests. There might be nutrition and health, which is in the center of the public attention, etc. I will not go through everything, but we can say post-harvest management has a triple benefit for people, planet, and profit. And we need to make sure that we talk the right language to the right people. And most importantly, all this is of direct relevance to the work that all the extension workers out there do. My last slide. Private sector engagement, and we will talk about this in the discussion. We should orient our actions towards the question, how can the production, the distribution, and also the work and the use of these technologies be made financially interesting and viable for all markets? How can we encourage entrepreneurship to bring post-harvest management options closer to the farmers? And there we propose, or that it, during the large event, it was proposed to use a very a market system approach in this. What does that mean? It means that we look at the actors that are there, at the entrepreneurs, at artisans, retailers, service provider, and ask ourselves who in this market is interested and has also the capacity to promote or to market or distribute such practices and technologies, and support then as a project these market actors in creating linkages and to disseminate, promote the technology. Rather, and that's the other case, we should not, as an NGO or project, become service providers ourselves, distribute silos ourselves. Because what happens when once the project ends, there's no one to continue this. If we use subsidies, the representatives there in Bellagio, they clearly said we should focus our subsidies on creating demand, for example, awareness creation, training, etc., and not on supply, on the supply side of the technologies, meaning we should not, as I said, distribute silos for free, because at the end once the project ends, this will not remain. So sustainability should be in the center of interventions. And finally, linked to this, we should work very much on access to finance for farmers and small entrepreneurs. And there, the one key aspect is the information on the rentability, the profitability benefit of portfolio management. Again, I want to underline extension, the extension work as a crucial conveyor of all these messages and approaches. So with this, I have come to the end of my presentation. We will talk about the other action points more in the next webinar, which will take place in September. And I would like to just to show you these links where you can find further information on the larger statement and other related resources. With this, I want to hand over again to Angela to launch the discussion and want to thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Raphael, for this interesting presentation. It's been great to have been given this introduction to the important statements that were made in Bellagio and to which outcomes this discussion were led, so that we now have a basis for our discussion. I want to welcome once again some more participants. So we are growing in flock, that is great. Hello, everybody. We are now at the point where we can start to involve you, the participants, more in this discussion. But first, I want to say I didn't turn on my camera for the moment because it seems there are quite some technical issues. So for the moment, we just try without video camera, and hopefully this will help the people who have a little bit of technical problems to hear us better. And then I also wanted to say that, of course, this presentation of Raphael Dischl will be available. It will be posted on a link on AFAS, so that I will show you again at the end. So, yes, and thank you, Cesar. You could also download the presentation right now with the link that was sent by Cesar in the chat. If you see the chat message at the left below, you can download the presentation there. So now, for the chat, we hopefully can turn to more content-wise questions in the chat now. I suggest you ask questions in typing a chat message, and then we will hopefully alert. And you can also, in the list of participants, you can raise your hand, clicking the smiley that you see in the left-hand bar just beside the presentation window. And then we can also give you the word. You will, every time when we open the mic for you, you will have to kind of confirm, and then your microphone is open. So again, welcome to this discussion. And first, I wanted to ask, are there any questions of understanding to Raphael? So not yet any content-wise contributions, but first, does anybody have a question of understanding that he or she wants to ask Raphael regarding his presentation? please write us a chat message or raise your hand. That would be good. There is one message that is being written, I see. And sometimes it takes a little bit of time until the things arrive in our windows. So this is one of the famous patience moments I asked at the start. So everything was clear. That is very good. I am happy about this. So let us start the discussion now. I think Rafael showed very well that that post-harvest management has a lot to do with food security, and this is also why it is part of the SDG 12.3 about food waste, because it has a lot to do with many other factors. Now there is a question coming in that is already going to a very technical level. I will give a little moment to Rafael to ask, then I think we come back to the main question that our discussion should be on, and that is not so much on the tools for post-harvest management, but we really want to talk about how should we communicate, how can we make this the benefits of good post-harvest management known to more people. And please, while we are answering the question of Tembi, you can already think at your stories that you have to share with us about successful stories that show us how post-harvest management was effectively communicated and how it changed people's lives or markets in the following. So there was a question, yes, from Sejo, if I spell that name right. You will be opened the microphone so you can join us and we can hear your question. Hello? Can you hear us, Sejo? And you need to open your microphone. You need to accept that your microphone is opened, please. And then we can hear you. Yes. Hello, Sejo. If we cannot hear you, I think we try with Tembani. Can you please try to open his microphone? Yes, hello? Tembani, I'm really sorry if I don't spell right your names. Do you hear me, and can you please accept that the microphone is given to you so that we can hear you too? Hello? Yes? Hello, Zetro. I see you. I see that you are there and you could speak up, so I'm looking forward to hearing you. Hello? Oh, you are coming and going. It's a bit, yeah. Okay, so there is a question. Salim, you are, yeah, Salim, there will be Cesar answering to you. We try again with Tembani. Are you there? Let's try. There are other people holding their hand up. How about Miguel? Do you see him? Okay, we are opening for Miguel, but in the meantime, Rafael, if you want to answer the question of who was it? You have to open your microphone.
Yeah, hi, this is Rafael speaking. I see that the question of Tembani, which is, are there any biological control strategies for aflatoxins? And I will ask just very short, very briefly, there is this new product, it's called Aflatase, and it's a biocontrol treatment. Yes, actually based on a non-harmful strain of the fungus. It's a.
Now we hear you again, Rafael. Yes.
Right. So I was saying that Aflatase is a biocontrol treatment. Was developed by Kiri, among others, and it was it's a product that is based on non-harmful strains of the fungus, so of the Bacillus flavus, which managed to cross the Bacillus flavus. It's fine. So.
Hello, Miguel. Can you please close the microphone for a second again until Rafael
yes.
has finished, and then we will turn to you.
Well, I think I finished. I just
okay.
Present to check the links for Aflasafe. There's a lot going on in different countries in Africa on this
side. Okay, thank you very much, Rafael. Now we have the participants Miguel Chiso. You open your microphone again, please. So that we can hear your question, please. Yes. Hello.
Yes, hello. Okay.
When we are, I don't know.
Okay, I'm.
Yeah, we cannot understand.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Can we have Suleymana to say? Hello. Hello. Miguel asked his question also in the chat. Please, I did not understand. Maize can be stored in the image, shown in the presentation. So, Rafael, can you for a moment answer this question? I'm sorry, there's a little problem. We go back to the presentation image 4. How maize is effectively stored. Well, okay.
Yes.
And Rafael, I give the word to you.
Yeah, can you hear me? Okay, which number? No. Number four. Okay, the here is showing a storage device. It's a threshing machine.
Threshing machine.
Manually driven. So this is not a storage device. If you meant number four. It's a manual pressure. I'm not sure if that answers your question. Can you open your mic? Okay. I mean, the hermetic storage options show that there's no storage in the storage process. The remaining oxygen depleted within a few minutes, so these are just a few information technologies. Some times process a problem is the secondary humidification can happen when, for example, if the hardness is not dried properly, and then filled in silos, and really lead to complete loss of the hardness due to fermentation process. Actually, the drying process prior to filling these bags or silos is probably the most crucial part in the whole process, because you can lose the whole moist grains in it, it can lead to fermentation.
Hello, here is your facilitator again. I'm sorry, I was off for a moment. Technical problem. I do hope you hear me well now. I had an interesting question of Celso Barroso, who is joining us from Mozambique, as far as I know. And he says, I would like to know experiences of financing mechanisms of small farmers to acquire post-harvest management technologies. So, if we are freely changing between our themes of how to boost communication on post-harvest management, and the questions around the private sector engagement. This is a very interesting question. So I would like to know from other participants if they have experiences on financing mechanisms of smallholder farmers to acquire post-harvest management technologies. This is a very interesting question because in the end, the farmers should be able to use these technologies to benefit from all the benefits of post-harvest management, like improving food security, like improving food safety, reducing unnecessary resource use, and increasing the profits for value chain actors. So please write us your questions. There is a question from Dominique Leclerc. So he will be open the microphone if you can accept, and make your proposal to us. He's coming. Yes, Dominic. Did you accept that we gave the microphone to you, please? Yes, hello, Dominic. We unfortunately cannot hear you. So I read the question. You say, you ask if hermetic bags should be bought by farmers and if the donor community should not give them for free. I think if we go back to Raphael's presentation, one of the conclusions from the Bellagio learning workshop was exactly that the use of subsidies for inputs was not very sustainable. Do you want to comment on this again, Raphael? Not for the moment, but this is, you can download the presentation and you will see that this option was not the one that would be the preferred by the community. There's a question Miguel, who says, I wish to share experiences of Cameroon on access to post-harvest management technologies. We want to try again with your microphone if you are in a more quiet room, maybe now. And if not, I would like to ask you also to share your question written. By the way, we will all the chats will be also in a chat log that will be made.
Hello?
Yes, hello.
Hello?
Hello.
Yes, hello.
I'm using. Okay, Okay, can we make another try and going on? Okay, I give the word to Cesar, our technical facilitator.
Hello, everyone. Just a tip, if you want to ask a question, you can post it in the chat, but we want to invite you to open your microphone to ask a question. The best is if you plug in your headset. It can be the headset that you use for your phone, because that comes with a microphone and the speakers. So you can connect that to your laptop or to your phone so that we can properly hear you. And when we open your microphone, please try to be in a room that's quiet or that there's not much noise so we can hear you properly. If you can't hear us anymore or there's any problem, you can simply finish the webinar and join again with the headset connected to the laptop and it will work fine. Thank you very much. Back to you, Angela.
Thank you, Cesar, for these instructions. I hope this helps with keeping the line open for as many contributions as we might have. I'm just reading that Sergio Menza is writing an interesting chat. He says, at the BOP Innovation Center, I don't know where it is, we use the voucher, the post-harvest funding. It's a good starting capital. It needs to be backed with a sound business model.
Okay, yes, do you hear me?
Now I hear.
Ah, great. Okay. I'm honored to be the first one to ask the question properly. to introduce briefly myself, I'm working at BOP Innovation Center. We are based in Utrecht in the Netherlands. And we are an international organization, and we are currently organizing the Food Connection Challenge in Nigeria and Benin. And basically, the idea is an hybrid between a prize that we are giving for the best applicant of a competition and an incubation program in order to develop a solution against post-harvest losses or for reduction of post-harvest losses. So we are currently implementing this program in Benin and Nigeria, and we might work in other countries in the next years. And there's some subsidies, and one of them is the one provided by Post-Harvest Network, because they are focusing on post-harvest losses, and they give some vouchers in order to implement the idea of agribusiness member or company. So that's a possibility which is, as far as I know, works on the whole continent, so not only in Benin and Nigeria, but also in other countries. But it has to be somehow structured and directed through this post-harvest network. And we have a good example because we organized already an edition of this Food Connection Challenge in Ghana. And in Ghana, it was how could we package groundnut paste in a vacuum cleaned packaging using also low-cost technology. And that's it was the winner of the Food Connection Challenge of the edition of last year. So it worked actually quite well to just also to identify the right solution, to find the right fit according also to the need of the company.
Thank you very much, Sergio. Thank you very much, Sergio. Interesting contribution. So if I understand well, you fostered and financed a kind of competition between small businesses so that they can provide solutions. And who were these people who participated in this competition? That would be interesting to us. So if you can elaborate on this, that would be interesting. Are you there still? Okay, so your microphone, yes, will be opened again.
Okay, I can only tell on the Beninese and the Nigerian challenges because I was not in charge of the Ghanaian one. But in Benin, we had 88 candidates from the private sector, so small processors or so SMEs basically, and producers mostly, and also some companies who are actually providing solution, so packaging company, for example, or processor who are offering techniques in order to reduce post losses. And in Nigeria, we had over 278 candidates, so a huge demand and coming from the ground. And we tried now to analyze all this data. That's a lot. And we will organize, we are organizing a selection committee, and they will select 18 candidates for, so 10 candidates for each country in Benin and Nigeria, and they will be the best one to follow this incubation that we're organizing this summer up to fall.
Thank you very much. For those who have maybe lost or not understood which organization you are from, I would encourage you to write your email or your contact or the name of your organization in the chat so that we have that and that anybody who is interested in what you were just telling us about or your solutions. Yes, thank you. I see it coming. Food Connection Challenge. Very good. So everybody can contact you who wants to do this. Now there is an interesting other contribution of Ogema. We will give him the microphone to share his contribution with us. It's loading the microphone. Okay, Celcio is also still waiting to take the word, but Ogema is here. I'm sorry if I'm not spelling right your name. Do you want to take the word, please, and tell us about your story, please?
Hello.
Hello, you can speak a bit up.
Hello.
Hello, we Hello. Hear you. Hello. Please yes, tell us your story. Me? Yeah, please tell us your story.
Yeah, my name is Ogema from Masinde Muliro University of Science and Technology, Western Kenya. We have had a good experience with hematic bag, use of hematic bags. I think this was being promoted by Purdue University from the US under the business name Pix Bags. The bags are being manufactured in Nairobi, I think, by a private company. And we had a chance to talk to farmers who have used them. We did some surveys, and they were basically very, very small-scale farmers. Their experience was that the bags were very effective in the management of pests of stored produce, mostly pests of maize. Actually, from our survey, 100% of the farmers said the bags were effective. The only limitation they said was the price. The price is, I think, $2.5 per bag as compared to what they are used to, which is $0.5 per bag. So they find $2.5 per bag a little bit high, but the effect is very good. they are getting 100% protection of their grain, and they are very, very much keen to use the bags. That is my experience.
Thank you very much, Ogema. This is very good to hear that you can set up a good network where the selling and buying of hermetic bags works, and their farmers really benefit from it and can save their harvests. How is it in this case? How are bags voted? Are farmers just talking to each other, or is there any other initiative that promotes the bags for everybody?
Yeah, we have the local initiatives now by the county governments. In our setup now, the extension services are devolved to local governments. So the local governments are taking it up through their extension services, but the reach is very poor. We also have some non-governmental organizations. The one I used to, I interacted with in the field was Christian, it is called that.
Hello, we don't hear you anymore very well. Thank you for this contribution. Yes, and I see Celcio is waiting. We will talk to Celcio in a moment. So, Ogema, if I understand well, the business model is entirely private in your case. Is that right?
Hello.
Hello.
Hello. Is
Hello,
that...
Angela.
Okay. Go. Hello, Celcio. Good to hear you.
Yeah.
Please. What do you want?
Yeah.
To
my name is Celcio. Hello.
Yes. Please speak. We hear you. Thank you.
Yeah. My name is Celcio Barros. Working for Helvetas Mozambique in the PHM program. Sorry, my English is not very good because I speaking Portuguese. But yeah, I will share some experience about the business model in Mozambique. Now, have a problem with the small scale farmers to buy the technologies because this technology is very expensive. For example, the super bag. A super bag is necessary to import from Tanzania, and the taxes is very high. And when these agro dealers take this for community, it's very expensive. And now looking for the ways to farmers buy with a low price. But now starting the program of the credit and saving in communities. A check with the possible these small scale farmers. It's possible to acquire these technologies. But now need for another experience from the another countries. It's possible to verbalize this process. And after these meetings, it's necessary to change the communication and change the emails because it is necessary to know the different countries, the ways to these farmers no good incomes. It's possible, need this technology, but not possible to buy. Thanks.
Thank you, Celcio. Am I understanding right that the super bags are coming into Mozambique, but it's difficult for farmers to buy them? So So what role could farmer organizations play? Sergio?
Sorry?
I asked what role farmer organizations could play in helping that super bag can maybe be imported in bulk, and for the single farmers, the price would be lower then. Is that an option that you see?
Yeah, the experience for farmers organization not possible because these farmers not trusting himself. And now the technology is bought by individual farmers. And for example, the one super bag, and now up to 400 meters. And it's very expensive because you put the product, for example, the maize. When you sell these maizes, cost benefit is very expensive. Not this product, the conservation, when sell, not pay this the one bag of the super bag. And now with the node of the Farapan in Mozambique, have a lobbying with the government not to reduce these taxes for imports. And you're waiting now the result in the future. About metal silos is very expensive because this problem of the crisis in Mozambique, economic crisis. And now you compare the dollar in the meticash, dollar is very high. And these companies, the factory, these metal sheds, the cost is very high. And when this private sector buy these metal sheds, in this process of production, the silos, now it's very expensive because 1 year or 2 years ago, one is metal silos around it to 300 meters. But now this price is very higher because the dollar is higher. These companies to produce these metal sheds, the Indian company, and they bring this material in outside of Mozambique, and they will import this material to fabricate the metal sheds, and the when production for the business model is very expensive now. And now it's necessary to find new ways of financing this.
Okay. Yes, I understand.
Every more interested to farmers to buy this, but it's very expensive now. Principle for the small scale farmers.
Obrigado, Sergio. Thank you very much for your contribution. So I understand that for single farmers, it's still very expensive to provide themselves with the means. However, I was not sure if the route for to organize these farmers was tried out. And there you mentioned, and then you mentioned the policy level. This will be subject of the next webinar that we will provide in September. So there we will speak on policy questions mainly. You also spoke about the metal silos. I know that, of course, the exchange rate has a big impact if you have to import the raw goods. Now, I know there are good examples. We have several questions now, or several people. I think Sulemana Tia wanted to contribute to us again. And yes, thank you, Celcio, again. Let's go hear Sulemana. Hello? Hello, Sulemana? We cannot hear you. I don't know if you hear us. I just wanted to draw your attention also on the chat. There was an answer by Rafael, but maybe you want to elaborate a little bit on this. Yeah, no, not yet. There is also Jerry. Hello, Jerry. Thanks for joining us. You speak about. Can you open the mic, maybe, for Jerry? Can you open the microphone for Jerry Agessa, please? Because he is sharing with us a story about business incubation for young entrepreneurs. I think this is about Uganda. Am I right, Jerry?
Yeah, you're right. This is Uganda. Do you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, but a little bit low. So if you can speak up a little bit, it would be helpful.
Okay, that should work better, right?
Yes, that's much better.
Okay, this is the case in Uganda. Down here, many agri-dealers have these bags and they import them from the neighboring country. But you know, they don't have enough time and resources to go for outreach, to go and sell these into among the farmers. So what happens is some organization here in Uganda is working with the universities to go out and, you know, get these guys who are soon graduating, or the ones that have graduated. They build their business skills, they build education skills. So they go out and talk to farmers and sell these technologies. And when they sell the technologies, they sell them for profit. The farmers buy, but also the young graduates are able to do some business out of the technologies. So that is a short story that I wanted to share with the participants.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think this is interesting to keep or to interest young people and to offer them a little bit of help to build up their own business models. This is an interesting approach that you share from Uganda. Thank you very much, Jerry. Now there is also a contribution again from Cameroon. Miguel, we had a bit difficulties with your microphone, so I'm reading out your contribution. In Cameroon, access to post-harvest management technologies by smallholder farmers is possible through the help of the government with the different projects put in place. However, and then it doesn't go on. Well, I think we should again keep to the recommendation Miguel, I'm really sorry, but when you open your microphone, there's just a lot of noise for everybody, so I'm really sorry. We had to close this again. So you continued saying interested farmers need to come near to those projects and some advisor will be put at their disposal, but the problem is that the limit resources of these farmers. Well, I think that is exactly the challenge that is there, to link the farmers or farmer groups with people who set up businesses. So the little story, the story we had from Uganda just before is one of the possible approaches. And I would also like to remind what we heard from Nigeria before. So the support to young, new, innovative businesses that might close the link between farmers and the people who provide the post-harvest management solutions. So there is another discussion where Rafael is already answering. So also from the side of the projects and our project, the research is going on to build links where there are in the whole market systems. It is true there in many countries there exist gaps in the market systems. So these are the gaps that we are trying to address in the projects without relying on input subsidies. I forgot to say before there was this of the contribution of Cherry and the contribution of Suleimana before. You can also post the links to your organization so that the people who are interested in your examples can contact you. Now, there was one subject that was mentioned by Rafael in his presentation, and that was the theme about awareness on communication. We were talking more on the business proposals so far, but is there any other any person who can share with us a successful story or who can suggest us strategies to improve awareness and communication on post-harvest management? We would be, there is a question from Miguel about an African program focused on communication and sensitization on PHM. I'm not sure if I understand your question right. However, we will show you the link to the community of practice of NGO that is fostering knowledge exchange on post-harvest management. And then we also propose that you inscribe yourself in the D groups of AFAS, African Forum Agricultural Advisory Services, so that you can get some more information on what is going on on the level of communication. Yes, I see Jerry is giving us his email. Thank you very much. This is helpful maybe also for Miguel, that he can contact you and get some more information. And there is also another communication coming up. Is there any other participant who would like to give us more ideas and suggestions on communication, on successful communication about post-harvest management? Yes, we are looking forward to more communications. However, I would propose that if there is no pressing question anymore, we are for this webinar coming to the end of our presentation. There is one more poll question that we would like you to give your opinion about, and this is about the target audience to raise awareness. We have not so much been talking about this theme so far. Can you please vote on this question from whom you think should be the target audience to raise awareness? Yes. Have you all voted? We are only at 8. I hope, yes. Is it a difficult decision? Maybe it is. Write us if you have another idea. We forgot to put the category of other. Yes. So the question was, who should be the target audience to raise awareness on post-harvest losses? What do you think about this? I think we close the poll now. Okay, so here we have the result. Not everybody has been able to vote, but you are chatting very actively. So farmer organizations should, in your opinion, be the target audience. This is an interesting outcome. I think this should be reflected in further discussions. So, and somebody says that the processors should also be included in the poll. That's true, because the processors are definitely an important link in the market system, or let's say in the value chain. Yes, thank you very much for answering this poll. We are coming to an end of this webinar. I think we had some interesting contributions on what could be initiatives to foster post-harvest management and to foster businesses who cover the last mile to the farmers and to make technologies available to the farmers. Although we also heard about some current challenges in the systems. So it's true, there's much of work ahead of us, but this is something that should not discourage us to continue work and make more post-harvest solutions available so that post-harvest loss can be reduced. I see there are more contributions coming in. However, I cannot answer to all of them now. I will show you where the discussions will go on in a moment. But now I would like to give the word shortly to Raphael Dischel to make a final comment on what he heard, and maybe link it to the projects that we run on post-harvest management, or again to the Bellagio statement that we heard you explaining to us at the start. Okay. I cannot hear you yet.
Yeah, hi, Rafael again. Can you hear me? Great. Yeah, I was listening with a lot of interest to the different contributions and in written form and but also in the audio form. Thanks a lot for all your thoughts, and I'm sure that we will, for all those questions that have not been addressed yet, I would propose that we also try to keep in touch either bilaterally or on different platforms that will be also presented later on or mentioned by Angela. I think the what we do today or with this webinar is actually kind of one of the modus operandi of our program that we implement as a mandate from SDC, the Swiss Agency for Development and Cooperation, because the idea behind the program is actually not to reinvent things that technologies or practices, but rather to find out how can those be promoted in the local context in African countries. And one of the key, let's say, key aims of the program is also to make the different linkages, regional exchange between the different countries, to exactly find to be able to compare the different approaches that are used in the countries. I was very interested in hearing Cedillo's input on the on the business model or the challenge funds that you're using in your program. Indeed, we also have let's say considered this type of modality, and I will be very interested in discussing further what you learn out of this these entrepreneurs that you support with such projects. And I think again back to the webinar, this is one of the of our key aims to make this regional exchange happening. And I would also ask you to continue to share your ideas through this platform and also to further platforms that we will mention in a few minutes. Lastly, I don't want to be too long, but I think one point that came out very clearly from the Bilateral event discussions there, and I also felt it here again in the different chats and contributions, that post-harvest management should be more than just quantitative loss management. It should be more and more also about qualities, quality in terms of food quality, in terms of nutritional value, health. I think we have been talking about aflatoxin, but also other health risks that are connected with the way how food is handled. And I, from my experience and from what I hear from you and also the other stakeholders we are in contact with, especially in African countries, this topic of nutrition and health-related issues comes more and more to the on the agendas. So it's also momentum at the political level, I think, that we can use, and we should use also we should use this sensitivity of decision makers to bring in the post-harvest management as a topic more prominently in the policies. And I think also the qualitative issue from another point of view, from the point of view of entrepreneurs, processors, small processor or traders that and farmers, that especially farmers who can sell their product at a better price by making a difference with better handling at the different post-harvest stages. So this is just maybe a small summary from my point of view, where I also see a bit the tracks or the next year. I think quality and nutrition should be coming more prominent in all these discussions. So I think from my side, I don't want to be much longer, But just on behalf of the project, thank you very much for all your contributions. I have learned a lot. I hope you have learned a lot too. And, I hand over again to Angela and Cesar, who will do the wrap up.
Thank you very much, Raphael, for these words and putting the things in perspective again. I have a last poll question for you. We again have one solution to choose because we want you to tell us your preference. And the question is, in which field does entrepreneurial innovation need most support to provide post-harvest management solutions? We are coming back to the business questions. Can you vote on this question? As a last poll. Thank you for your voting. They are coming in. I see it. Okay, so it has stopped a little bit. I think we will show the results. What you think about this question? So we see that business card coaching, you think, is an important element to foster innovation in the area. Well, very good. It's thank you very much for your contributions also to these questions. And I see exchanges and contacting is going on the chat. I think that is very good. We want with this webinar also put people into contact, and this is a great development. So now, before we end this webinar, I want to inform you that, of course, the recording of the webinar, the presentations, and the chat transcription will be made available to all participants and other interested person, and this is under the link that you see in the presentation. And these links will also be shared through the usual D groups of AFAS, from where most of you also got the invitation to this webinar. Yes, as I said, the presentation will also be available. And we also want to mention that a further discussion could go on the AFAS virtual social networking platform. So please do not hesitate to log you into this discussion and continue sharing your good and interesting examples. So the link was just posted again in the chat, as you can see. Now, further information is also available on the Twitter account of AFAS and on its Facebook page. And I would also not miss to mention the community of practice on food loss reduction of the Food and Agriculture Organization. They have a homepage which I mentioned here in English and also in French. There is also the project that we mentioned before, the Brain Post-Harvest Loss Prevention Project in Tanzania. That provides more information and also make you available there a link on this project. So, yes, you will get this information, and this is the moment to say thank you for your attention. We would like to ask you a last question, and this is about how useful this event was to you? Do you think it was very useful, or it was more or less useful, or even a waste of time? Please give us your vote. We will be very interested. And I must say, it was also for us a big learning experience. I can tell you that the answers to the poll are anonymous. You don't have to be scared to answer the poll. So please give us your vote. It is only for us to learn. And I'm again sorry for the technical problems that we had for some moment, but I think most of the time we were hearable and seeable. And yes, from what I see from the poll results, can you make them? Yes, thank you very much. So most of you found this event very useful, and some of you at least useful. So I'm very happy to see this. Thank you very much. It was great having you on this discussion. Thank you also very much for your contributions, and I see the discussions and the communications on the chats are going on, even between people in the same country. So this is interesting. And yes, this is it from our side. As I said, there will be a second webinar in September, tentatively on 5th of September, and we will be very happy to hear, see, read you again at that time. Yes, I am reminded about the emails with the links, but the AFAS will send out the link to all the information that I mentioned before, as said. So thanks again for your very positive comments. It was a pleasure to facilitate this webinar for you. And as I said, I hope to hear and see you again. Thank you very much. All the best to you. Bye-bye.